Welcome to the Cardiac EMA Learner Series, a unique video tutorial program under the aegis of Indian Association of Cardiac Imaging. This program is focused on beginners and intermediate imagers with learning happening through short sessions and case-based discussions. We are grateful to experts from different parts of India who have helped us in putting this program together. Please do feel free to give us your feedback so we can continually improve such training opportunities. This session is brought to you by Dr. Richa Kothari, who is a consultant cardiothoracic radiologist in Narayana Institute of Cardiac Sciences, Bangalore. Her areas of expertise include cardiac CT and MRI in adults and children and thoracic and vascular imaging. She received the 2018 Regional Award by the European Association of Cardiovascular Imaging in Barcelona, Spain, and holds a Level 3 certification from the same association. She has won multiple research presentations at national and international level and is a executive committee member of the Indian Association of Cardiac Imaging. She has co-authored multiple textbook chapters and is part of the DNB teaching program.
Hello everyone, I am Dr. Richa Kothari, cardiothoracic radiologist working at Narayana Hrudayalaya in Bangalore. In this video, I'll be continuing with cardiac MRI in congenital heart disease. We tend to see congenital heart disease as difficult. One of the reasons likely being that we are exposed to it on a lesser scale. However, if we develop an approach, it may make it more straightforward rather than intimidating. Cardiac MRI, as we know, has two components, that of morphology as well as function. It is the gold standard for ventricular volume and function analysis. Protocol for congenital heart disease and volumetry have been discussed in other videos in this series. In this video, we will discuss segmental approach and see few cases with increasing level of difficulty. Using the segmental approach, anatomy is assessed in three segments, first of which is the visceroatrial situs. Right atrial appendage is broad, blunt, and triangular, while the left atrial appendage is narrow, pointed, and finger-like. However, this may not be reliably identified by imaging, so non-cardiac organs are more helpful in determining situs. Situs may be solitus, inversus, or ambiguous. Situs solitus is the normal anatomical configuration with liver on the right side, stomach and spleen on the left side, trilobed lung with epiarterial bronchus on the right, and bilobed lung with hypoarterial bronchus on the left. Inversus is the exact inversion of a situs solitus. Situs ambiguous is neither solitus nor inversus. Two well-recognized configurations of situs ambiguous is left and right isomerism. In right isomerism, there is ersplenia, midline liver, bilateral trilobed lungs with epiarterial bronchus. It may be associated with total anomalous pulmonary venous return. Left isomerism is polysplenia by bilateral bilobed lungs with hypoarterial bronchus with interrupted IVC. It may be associated with partial anomalous pulmonary venous return. The orientation of the heart based on its base to apex axis determines whether it's a levocardia, dextrocardia, or mesocardia. Base to apex axis facing towards the left side is levocardia, towards the right is dextro, and towards the midline is mesocardia. The position of the heart in the chest cavity determines the position. Heart placed in the left side of the chest cavity is levo position, right side is dextro position, and in the middle is meso position. In this case, we can see that the liver is on the left, the spleen is on the right, and we can see that the base to apex axis of the heart is towards the right side. So this is the situs inversus with dextrocardia. Next step is determining the ventricular loop, which for practical purposes, without going deeper into embryology, is the loop when right ventricle is on the right side and L loop when left ventricle is on the right side. To identify the ventricles, there are a few points. The easiest of which is to identify the moderator band, which is the band which connects interventricular septum to the anterior papillary muscle. Moderator band is a structure of the morphological right ventricle. If sometimes there's a difficulty in identifying the moderator band, we can look at the septal surface of the ventricle, which is coarse with attachments on the RV side and smooth with no attachments on the left ventricular side. So in this case, this is the moderator band. So this is the right ventricle, which makes this a D loop. After that, the third step is to determine position of the great arteries. I find this clock diagram from radiographics makes it easy to understand. The position of great arteries is determined at the level of the valves. Normally related great arteries has aorta to the right and posterior. So inversus has aorta to the left and posterior. If aorta is to the right and anterior, it makes it a D transposition, and to the left and anterior, it makes it a L transposition. If great arteries arise from the same ventricle, it is called malposition rather than transposition. Other possible configurations are side-by-side great arteries or anterior-posteriorly related great arteries. In case there is atresia, it is denoted by X. Other possibility is truncus arteriosus, in which the common trunk gives rise to the great arteries. So when the great arteries arise from the corresponding ventricle, it is called concordance. From the opposite ventricle, it is called discordance. Similarly, when right atrium opens into the right ventricle, it is called atrioventricular concordance. However, if it opens into the left ventricle, it is called atrioventricular discordance. Once we have determined tilia, we follow a method called follow the flow of contrast, in which essentially we follow the course contrast would follow when injected. So in this normal case, we can see the liver is on the right, situs solitus. The moderator band makes this the right ventricle, which is on the right side, D loop. The aorta is to the right and posterior, solitus position of great arteries. This is how it is notified, SDS. Situs solitus, the loop of ventricles, solitus position of great arteries. Next, we go on to the flow of contrast. We can see there are dual SVCs. The right SVC drains into the right atrium. The left SVC drains into the coronary sinus to the right atrium. IVC opens into the right atrium. The right atrium drains into the right ventricle, which gives rise to the pulmonary artery. The pulmonary veins drain into the left atrium, which opens into the left ventricle, which gives rise to the aorta. Let us begin seeing cases. This is liver is on the right, situs solitus. The moderator band is on this ventricle, which makes this the right ventricle, delooping of ventricles. The aorta is to the right and anterior, arising from the right ventricle. So this is D transposition of great arteries, which makes it SDD. Further, we can see there is flow acceleration in the pulmonary artery, suggestive of pulmonary stenosis. We can see a VSD, and there is a right-sided aortic arch with mirror branching pattern. Right and left arch is determined based on the position of the trachea. Arch to the right of trachea is right arch, to the left of trachea would be a left arch. So this is the case with SDD configuration, detransposition of great arteries, pulmonary stenosis, VSD, and a right aortic arch. Let's see another case. Liver is to the right, spleen is to the left, cytosis. Next, we go on to the ventricular looping. We can see the moderator band is on the left side. So the right ventricle is on the left side. Left ventricle is on the right side. This makes it an L loop. Aorta, we can see, is to the left and anterior, arising from the right ventricle. So the configuration is SLL. See the flow of contrast. We can see that the right superior vena cava drains into the right-sided atrium along with the IVC, which opens into the right-sided left ventricle, which gives rise to the pulmonary artery. The pulmonary veins open into the left atrium, which drains into the right ventricle, which gives rise to aorta with a left-sided aortic arch. So this is the case of SLL configuration. This is called a case of congenitally corrected transposition of great arteries, where though the flow is correct, the aorta is arising from the right ventricle, which makes it the systemic ventricle, and it's prone to failure in the long term, causing morbidity and mortality in these patients. Let's see the next case. Liver is to the left, spleen to the right, situs inversus. Then the moderator band is in this ventricle. So this is the right ventricle, which is on the right side, D loop. So situs inversus, D loop of ventricles. Aorta is to the right and anterior, D transposition of arteries. Now let's follow the flow of contrast. We can see there are dual SVC. So the left SVC goes directly into the right atrium, which is on the left side. Right SVC drains into the coronary sinus, which in turn opens into the morphological right atrium, which drains into the left ventricle, which gives rise to pulmonary artery. The pulmonary veins drain into the right-sided morphological left atrium, which opens into the systemic right ventricle, which gives rise to the aorta. So this is again another case of congenitally corrected transposition of great arteries with IDD configuration and dual SVC. In transposition of great arteries, surgery developed initially was atrial switch by Mustard and Senning, in which SVC and IVC baffles are created to redirect their flow to the left ventricle. Pulmonary venous baffle is created to redirect its flow to the right ventricle. However, right ventricle remains the systemic ventricle. So, the commonest complication is failure of the systemic right ventricle. Other complications are baffle related, where there may be obstruction of the SVC or IVC baffle, or there may be leak from the baffles. Other complications include pulmonary stenosis, tricuspid regurgitation. Such postoperative patients require frequent monitoring with serial imaging. Let's see a case. This is the postoperative case. We can see liver is on the right, situs solitus. This is the moderator band, RV is on the right side, D loop. Now, if we see the aorta is on the right, D side by side configuration. Now, let's follow the flow of contrast and look at the baffles. This is the SVC. This is the baffle. This is the IVC limb of the baffle, and they are seen draining into the left ventricle. So the venous flow goes to the left ventricle, which gives rise to the pulmonary artery. Now the oxygenated blood from the lungs comes into the pulmonary veins. This is the pulmonary venous baffle, which is created, and it drains into the systemic ventricle, which is the right ventricle in this case, which gives rise to the aorta, which contains the oxygenated blood. In this is a post contrast 3D Dixon image, where we can see that the baffles do not show any leak or any obstruction and they are completely patent. So this is a case of post atrial switch for TGA with no baffle leak or obstruction. This is another case. We can see liver is on the right. This is the left ventricle. So this is the L loop. Now this is actually a case of post-atrial switch with Rastelli's repair. Rastelli's repair is directing flow from the left ventricle to the aorta with a VSD patch and creation of a pulmonary conduit using a homograft. So in this case, when we follow the flow of contrast, we can see this is the SVC, which is part of the baffle, SVC baffle. This is the IVC. So the systemic venous baffle with deoxygenated blood drains into the right ventricle in this case, from which we can see a pulmonary homograft arising, which supplies to the pulmonary arteries. There is some narrowing with flow acceleration in the pulmonary homograft. Then there is oxygenated blood from the pulmonary veins is seen to drain into the pulmonary venous baffle, which directs blood to the systemic ventricle, in this case, which is the left ventricle. Here we can see with the help of a VSD patch that flow is directed to the aorta. So due to a double repair with atrial switch as well as Rastelli's procedure, the left ventricle is the systemic ventricle in this case. This coronal cine image is also delineated well. This is post-contrast 3D Dixon image to look for leaks and obstructions in the baffle. In this case, we can see that there's some narrowing in the pulmonary homograft. This is the IVC, the IVC baffle, and the pulmonary venous and the SVC baffle appear patent with no leaks and obstructions. So this was a case of post-atrial switch and Rastelli's procedure for congenitally corrected TGA showing no baffle leak or obstruction with stenosis of the pulmonary homograft. In later years, surgery called arterial switch for TGA was developed, which had a better quality of life because the LV was the systemic ventricle in such cases. The surgery involved reposition of great arteries to the corresponding ventricle with reimplantation of coronaries. So, the complications associated with this surgery are coronary insufficiency or stenosis leading to myocardial ischemia, stenosis at the great arterial anastomotic sites or at the branch pulmonary arteries, neo-aortic or pulmonary regurgitation, ventricular dysfunction, or pulmonary hypertension. This is a case. You can see liver is on the right. This is the moderator band, delooping of ventricles. And we can see that the right ventricle gives rise to the pulmonary artery post-surgery. So now let's follow the flow of contrast. The right SVC is seen draining into the right atrium to the right ventricle, which gives rise to the pulmonary artery. Here we can see some narrowing in the right pulmonary artery in the osteoproximal segment. The pulmonary veins open into the left atrium, which drains into the left ventricle, which gives rise to the aorta. So not only this is a corrected flow circuit, it also makes LV the systemic ventricle. This is again a post contrast 3D Dixon image where we can see that there is severe osteoproximal stenosis in the right pulmonary artery. So this was a case of post arterial switch for TGA with severe osteoproximal right pulmonary artery stenosis. This was another post arterial switch for TGA case. Again, we can see that the right pulmonary artery is uniformly small with a moderate narrowing at the proximal segment. An associated additional finding in this case was moderate coarctation of aorta, which can be seen in sagittal angiography and volume rendered angiography image. Now let's see another case. We can see a midline liver makes it a situs ambiguous. We can see that one ventricle is bigger than the other. This is the moderator band. So there is a large right ventricle with a hypoplastic left ventricle, single ventricular morphology. Both the great arteries are arising from the right ventricle with aorta to the right and anterior. So this makes it a double outlet right ventricle with demalposition of great arteries. There is flow acceleration seen in the pulmonary artery, suggestive of pulmonary stenosis. There is a large ASD forming a common atrial chamber morphology. There's also a large atrioventricular septal defect. Now when we follow the flow of contrast, right SVC is seen draining into the right side of the common atrium. IVC appears to be draining into the left side of the common atrium. Common atrium drains via the atrioventricular septal defect into the functional single ventricle, which gives rise to both the great arteries. The pulmonary veins are seen to form a common channel, which is draining into the right SVC. That is seen better in this angiography image, where we can see all the pulmonary veins form a common channel into the SVC. So this was a case of ADD, double outlet right ventricle with demalposition of great arteries, pulmonary stenosis, hypoplastic left ventricle, atrioventricular septal defect, and total anomalous pulmonary venous connection. This is another case, situs solitus. This is the moderator band. This is the right ventricle, which appears hypoplastic. There is a ASD. There is atresia of the tricuspid valve. The right ventricle gives rise to the aorta. The left ventricle gives rise to the pulmonary artery. So this is deep transposition of great arteries. There is flow acceleration in the pulmonary artery, suggestive of pulmonary stenosis. And there is a large ASD. So if we follow the flow of contrast, we can see the right SVC draining into the right atrium. There's a large ASD. The left atrium opens into the left ventricle with a VSD, hypoplastic RV with tricuspid atresia. The pulmonary veins open into the left atrium. So SDD, tricuspid atresia, transposition of great arteries with pulmonary stenosis, hypoplastic RV, ASD and VSD are the findings. For such cases, Fontan is one of the available strategies, which is a series of palliative surgical procedures which direct the systemic venous return into the pulmonary arterial circulation, bypassing a ventricle. So this is especially in cases which preclude a successful biventricular repair like hypoplastic left heart syndrome, tricuspid atresia, atrioventricular septal defect which is unbalanced. In such cases, cardiac MR is accurate in quantification of volumes and is recommended for serial follow-up. In these post-operative cases, we need to look at the anatomy and function of the Fontan pathway. identify the obstructions, leaks, look for any thrombus formation, and look for collateral flow. We have to especially look for stenosis in the caval veins and the pulmonary artery stenosis. Phase contrast imaging allows quantification of the aortopulmonary collateral burden, which plays a crucial role because these collaterals add an additional volume load to the single ventricle and may benefit from intervention like coiling. Myocardial fibrosis may also cause progressive deterioration in such patients, which we can look for in the delayed enhancement sequences. Diffuse we can detect in T1 mapping sequences. This is a post-Fontan surgery case. We can see liver is on the right. This is the IVC, which we can see there's an extracardiac Fontan conduit, which connects it to the right pulmonary artery. Here we can see the right SVC, which is directly communicating with the RPA, which is the Glenn circuit. So this is a patent Glenn and Fontan circuit, where the systemic venous return is directly directed towards the pulmonary arteries. So then further we can see the pulmonary veins draining into the left ventricle, which open into the, you can see the pulmonary veins draining into the left atrium, which further opens into the single ventricle, which gives rise to the aorta. This coronal sine sequences show the Glenn and Fontan circuits very well. As we can see here, this is the Glenn and the Fontan circuit directly joining into the RPA. This is the post-contrast 3D Dixon sequence, in which also we can see that this is the Fontan circuit with no leak or thrombus. This is the Glenn. So we can see the patent Glenn and Fontan circuits with no leak or thrombosis. We can see a focal MPA stenosis, likely due to banding. So our report must contain the anatomy, which is easiest determined by the segmental approach, which we saw now. Situs, followed by ventricular loop, followed by position of the great arteries. Then we need to determine the atrioventricular and ventriculoatrial concordance, look for septal defects, follow the flow of contrast, especially, and look for systemic and pulmonary veins. In post-surgical cases, we have to keep an eye on the complications which are likely to happen in these cases. Another part of the report would be the functional assessment. If there is a particular clinical question asked, we need to answer it. Following this approach makes it less likely for us to miss findings in a case of congenital heart diseases, especially complex ones. This is an article which is very good for beginning to learn the segmental approach in congenital heart disease. Thank you.